Okay, hi. Building quick apps is building quick apps is not trivial, but it's fucking important for your product. And that's because performance directly affects your product. How? Well, at first, performance affects conversion and revenue. For example, AliExpress made their site faster by a third and started receiving 10.5% more orders. Google tried slowing down their search by half a second, and the users started making 25% less requests. A research group discovered that slowing a site down by a second decreases user satisfaction by 16%. And there are lots of such numbers and lots of such studies. Then, slow sites are extremely stressful. For example, when a user experiences a slow site on mobile, they have the same stress as if they were watching a horror movie. That's really terrible. And third, lots of users, lots of your users still use a slow connection. Like, for example, 2/3 of the world still use 2G or 3G. And if your app doesn't work on at least slow 3G, you lose this many users. And so, well, building quick apps through important is not trivial, but in 2018, it's easier than ever. And let's see why. So first, you want to build a quick app. But what to focus on? Like, there are lots of metrics and lots of things to track and lots of things to optimize, like page size, server time, time to first byte. Well, in fact, the two most important metrics to track are time to first meaningful paint and time to interactive. So if you want to build a quick app, you need to track these metrics. And what do they mean? Time to first meaningful paint is how quickly the page loads from the start till the first meaningful content is rendered. And meaningful content is the content the user came for. And here, the second screen is not the meaningful paint. It's just the first paint, the first plain paint. Because there's no content the user came for yet. The third screen is also not the meaningful content. Only the fourth screen is the first meaningful paint, because there's finally the content the user came for. And time to interactive is how quickly the page becomes interactive, so how quickly the user can start using the page since they started loading it. And the reason these metrics are this important, because they represent the user intentions, the user desire the best, because the user comes to your site to first read something and then to use something. So this is it. So this is what metrics to track, but what numbers to track? Like what time to interactive, time to first meaningful paint should you target? And to answer this, you need to know two numbers. First, users usually get impatient after 1 second of waiting. This is true for all kinds of computer tasks, for web tasks, for mobile tasks, for like everything. Then the average slow 3G speed is around 50 kilobytes per second. And you want to target slow 3G speed, because remember, most of world users still use 2G and 3G. And this is the least slow speed they most of them will have. And so, given these numbers, to make sure the user doesn't get impatient, and you don't want the user to get impatient because this affects your product metrics, to make sure the user doesn't get impatient, you need to render something on the screen into the first 1 second, or in the first 40 kilobytes. 40 kilobytes, not 50 kilobytes, because there would also be server delays and stuff like that that would extract time from loading. So your time to first meaningful paint should be 1 second, or around 40 kilobytes with slow 2G. And with time to interactive, it's more complicated. It's hard to tell the optimal time to interactive, because it largely depends on the kind of the app you develop. Like, if you develop a news site, Time to interactive doesn't really matter because the user comes to read news, and as soon as they see the news and start reading, they don't really care about everything else, and you can make your site interactive later. But if you have a single page app, time to interactive matters because they come to actually use your app. And so, well, it depends. But generally, you want to keep time to interactive at most 5 to 15 seconds. And remember that users lose attention and switch to different tasks after approximately 10 seconds. So this is it. And the third question is like, OK, you know, now you know what metrics to track. Now you know what target, what numbers you need to target, but where to track those metrics. And for this, we have Lighthouse. Lighthouse is Google's audits tool. It's built into Chrome DevTools. There's actually the audit step. If you never used it, go try it after this talk. And Lighthouse has lots of audits. And one of the audits is performance audit. And the performance audit gives a lot of useful info. And a part of that info is actually those metrics we want to track. It's time to first meaningful paint and time to interactive. And tracking your stats with Lighthouse is super easy. You just launch your site. You open it in Chrome, you go to the audit tool, you start the audit, and in 10, 20 seconds, you have the numbers. So that's it. And now let's get to how to actually build a quick app. And one more thing. You can install Lighthouse from NPM if you want to use it locally or on a CI. Yeah, you can run audits programmatically. That's cool. And now let's get to how to actually build a quick app. And let's start with time to first meaningful paint. And well, for the first meaningful paint, you have 1 second and 40 kilobytes. And 40 kilobytes is not a lot. Like most of popular libraries take around 20, 30, or even more kilobytes. That's minified plus gzipped. So that's exactly how much the user will be downloading. So it's likely you won't be able to fit your app into those 40 kilobytes. So instead of trying to fit your app, you do different kinds of optimizations. And today, in 2018, those optimizations are server-side rendering, critical CSS, preloading, and server-side optimizations. And let's start with server-side rendering. Well, what's server-side rendering? If you have a plain, simple, single-page app, the simplest way to render it is to just drop a div stack, a script tag that will render the app into the div tag, and serve that HTML to the client. And the problem with this is that the client will have to wait until the file script is loaded. And if the network is slow, they won't see the app at all until the script is loaded and until the app is rendered. So what is done instead is server-side rendering. And with server-side rendering, each time a client requests a page, each time, you render that page on the server, you collect the resulting HTML markup, you pass it into that HTML response you're serving to the client, see this root div has the markup inside it, and as soon as the client received that HTML response, the client can render this app immediately because they now have all the HTML they need for rendering. They don't need to download the script. And, well, in fact, configuring server-side rendering is hard. Like, you need to find the corresponding boilerplate for your React or Vue or Angular and Node app. You need to copy it. You need to configure it for your specific environment and technologies, and that's it. But at the same time, in 2018, server rendering is easier than ever because today we have tools that do this for you automatically. And one of such tools, the tool I personally recommend a lot, it's the Next.js framework for React. Or if you use Vue, there's a similar Nuke.js framework for you. And Next.js. Next.js is a framework that's similar to Create React App. Like, it doesn't force a lot of things about your app. It hides all the built-in complexity under the hood, but unlike great React app, it does server-side rendering, it does automatic per-route card splitting, it does preloading, and it does all these kinds of optimizations automatically without you needing to worry about it at all. And the only major requirement that Next.js has is that you need to structure your routes on the file system. Like, if you have those four routes, like an index route, a profile route, a profile settings route, and an about route, with Next.js, you'd have to put these routes into the file system into pages/index, pages/profile, pages/profile/settings, and pages/about files. And that's actually the only major requirement. And it could actually be quite a deal breaker for existing apps. Like, it could be hard to migrate existing apps to Next.js because of this. But on the other hand, you receive automatic server-side rendering, code splitting, and all of this stuff. And for new apps, Next.js works just great. So, well, and that's actually it about server rendering. So, not complex snippets of code on slides. Just take a tool and use it. It's this easy. That's it about server rendering. Next, critical CSS. You might know that styles block rendering. And what this means is that when you start loading a page, when a user starts loading the page, the browser won't render the page until it downloads the file CSS for that page, all the CSS file that this page needs. And this means that even if you server render your app, even if you surf on the initial HTML in all the necessary HTML in this initial HTML response, the user won't see the app immediately. They would have to wait for the file CSS to load. And in fact, that's logical because this behavior is logical because it would be weird if you go into a page and the browser render the page without CSS styles, because then you would see like weird HTML pages without styles, and then the page would blink, and then they would see the page with the styles applied. Like, that's not the best user experience. But the trick here is that CSS files usually include lots of things that aren't necessary for the current page, like CSS for current pages, or CSS for other pages, CSS for that one JavaScript model component that gets opened like twice a week, and all this CSS increases your time to first meaningful paint, and all this CSS delays your app rendering. And how to solve it? You solve it with the critical CSS approach. And with critical CSS approach, First, you split your styles to critical and non-critical. Critical styles are the styles that are required for rendering the current page, and non-critical styles are the styles that aren't required for rendering the current page. Critical styles might be styles for the layout or styles for the text. Non-critical might be styles for the other pages or styles for our JavaScript model component, and you do the splitting for every page. Then, you inline your critical styles to HTML, and that's important to make sure the browser don't need to make extra requests to load that critical CSS from the server. It's important to make sure the critical CSS is available immediately so that the browser can render it, can render the page. And then, third, you fetch and apply non-critical styles later. And not like really later, but just later, in an unblocking manner to not block page rendering. And well, in fact, this might look hard, and I personally wouldn't want to do this split into critical and non-critical styles on every page. And I guess nobody would want to, but the cool thing is that we have tools for this. And the first such tool is Critical by Adios Menu. It's a console line utility that takes your HTML page, runs it in a headless Chrome, in a Chrome that doesn't have an UI, tries to understand what styles are required for the initial rendering, and extract the styles into a separate file or just inline them into into an HTML file, just like you would ask it. And it actually works quite nice. The only problem with it is that it works with HTML pages. Like, it takes HTML pages as the input, so it might not work really well with highly dynamic single page apps. But otherwise, it's nice. And other tools are CSS in JS libraries, for example, styled components. And the cool thing about CSS in JS libraries is that most of CSS in JS libraries support server-side rendering. And this means that each time we render a page on the server, we could ask the CSS in JS library to extract styles that were used during that server-side rendering session, and return those styles into a string, and then pass those styles into the HTML response and so on. And the cool thing, the very cool thing about this is that CSS in JS libraries collect styles by analyzing what components are called during your server rendering session. So this means that the resulting styles would only include those styles that were really used during your first server rendering session, no more and no less. And this is like the perfect critical CSS. And this, for example, how it looks with styled components. You create a style sheet object, you wrap your app with this style sheet object, then you render your app with React DOM, and during rendering, the style sheet object collects styles that were used. And in the end, you just ask that style sheet object to give you your critical CSS. And that's three lines of code, and it just works. So, and the most wonderful, the most amazing, the most incredible thing about this is that you really don't need to think about this at all. You just configure this tool, and you write code as you write it, and everything else, every optimization works automatically. It's 2018. Wow. So that's it about critical CSS. Now, critical CSS and server-side rendering optimize time to first meaningful paint for the current page, like the page the user visits for. But it would also be cool to optimize time for future pages, because remember, it affects your product metrics. And for this, there's preloading. And what's preloading? Preloading is when you know that you would need some resources slightly later, and you go and fetch those resources ahead of time so that when you actually need them, you have them right next to you and you don't need to fetch them again. So there are two kinds of preloading. One is prefetching resources, like if you have prefetching JavaScript bundle for the next page, or prefetching an image for the next page, or something like that. And the second kind is prefetching data. It's like prefetching, I don't know, the user profile, prefetching the content of the post. And let's start with prefetching resources. Prefetching resources is actually easy. Under the hood, prefetching resources uses technologies like linker helper fetch, or linker helper preload, or HTTP to server push. But I won't talk about this technology today, because in fact, you would almost never need to use this technology directly. Instead, again, we have tools. And tools that help with prefetching resources are, first, Next.js. Next.js has a link prefetch attribute that tells Next.js to prefetch files required for rendering that Rarely wrote that links to, and that the link links to. And how it works is that, for example, you have a home page where you have a link to the profile page. And if you put the prefetch attribute on that link, Next.js, as soon as Next.js loads that home page, it will preload the profile page bundle in the background. And when the user finally clicks that profile link, the page will render immediately without waiting like at all. This is Next.js. Then for Webpack, there's a Webpack prefetch command, magical command. They call it magical. And if you use import to cut split your bundle into dynamic chunks, you could use the Webpack prefetch command to ask Webpack to preload your chunk ahead of time. So if you use import to move your profile.js profile.js component into a separate bundle, you can put Webpack prefetch magical command. True. And Webpack will add this rel prefetch tag that would prefetch that bundle in the background. Then there's prefetch Webpack plugin that does the same, but for all imports. And there's even Workbox Webpack plugin that prefetches all your bundle or all the resources Webpack emits, not just the bundles that are next to your current page, but all the resources with the service worker and caches it. Then prefetching data. And prefetching data is harder than prefetching resources because there are no automatic solutions for that yet. But still there are some tools. And well, the really cool example with prefetching data I like is the Dev2 website. Dev2 is like a community for developers. And what Dev2 does is that each time you hover a post, they prefetch the content of that post in the background. So the moment you click that post, the content is already prefetched, and you can render it automatically. So this is how it works, and it's wonderful. So let's see it one more time. See, you hover, it was prefetched, and you click, and it rendered instantly. Cool. And as I said, the problem with prefetching data that there are no automatic solutions for that yet. But still, there are some things that we can do with it. And for example, for Next.js, there's a curl snippet that adds a with data attribute to your links. And with this code snippet, if you have a link that prefetches the component, you can add the link with data attribute. And with this attribute, Next.js would also prefetch the data that is required by that page. Not only the page bundle, but also the page data. And this works because Next.js actually allows declaring what data page needs. So if you write your code with Next.js, this would work just with a single component. And if you don't use Next.js, you could patch your link tag at on mouse over event listener and dispatch a Redux action each time your link is covered, so that you prefetch your data in the background when the user covers the link, like on Dev2. That's it. Well, so that's it about preloading. And the final thing about time to first meaningful paint I want to talk is server-side optimizations. And the thing is, there are lots of server-side optimizations you might need to do. It's HTTP2, it's CDN, it's Brotli compression, it's caching headers, it's better server response time. And implementing all these things might take a lot of time. But you remember it's 2018. We have tools. We can put tools even for this. So one of the tools that does this optimizations for you is Cloudflare. Cloudflare is a service that proxies all your site requests through itself and applies optimizations on the fly, like this. And Cloudflare supports all these kinds of wonderful optimizations we've just talked. It supports HTTP2, it supports Brotli, it supports CDN for static files, and actually the CDN has a very quick responses, and it even protects your app from denial of service attacks and other attacks. And all of this is, by the way, free. And the only thing you need to do to connect your site to Cloudflare is to go to Cloudflare, register there, move your DNS name servers to Cloudflare. That's 20-minute thing. And after this, everything just works, and your site magically starts working twice faster or three times faster without any of your work. That's cool. And the second tool is Netlify. Netlify is an amazing static site hoster. And how it works is you connect your GitHub repository to Netlify, push something into your repository, and then Netlify builds that, and starts serving that content from the CDN. And what it does, it supports GP2, it supports CDN for all of your files, not just static files, like for HTML responses too. And it does all kinds of other optimizations. And it's also free unless you want to use some of the dynamic features. So Cloudflare for apps, Netlify for static sites. And boom, your server responses are 3 times faster. So that's it about time to first meaningful paint. For time to first meaningful paint, you need to do server-side rendering, critical CSS, preloading, and server optimizations. And for server-side rendering, Next.js is your friend. For critical CSS, you use CSS ingest libraries or the critical tool by Diosmani. For preloading, you use, again, Next.js or Webpack tools or something else. And for server optimizations, Cloudflare or Netlify. Now, time to interact. And OK, so one sec. Yeah, thanks. I think it's time to interactive. Time to interactive is how quickly the user can interact with your app. And it's important because if you have a single page app and your time to interactive is high, even if you do server-side rendering, if you do all this optimization we just discussed, the user will see the app immediately, but they won't be able to use it immediately. And this would get frustrating. Very frustrating. Very, very, very frustrating. Like, really frustrating. Yeah, it finally loaded. And the primary thing that blocks or that affects time to interactive is JavaScript, obviously, because interactive is JavaScript. JavaScript is interactive, and now the important thing about JavaScript is that's kind of a special resource. All other resources you load, like CSS files, like images, like fonts, like other things, the primary blocker for them, the primary delay source for them is the network. And if you load a CSS file, as soon as the browser loads the CSS file, the browser could just apply that file, and that's it. But with JSS, there's a whole different problem. JavaScript executes, and that's like really bad. For example, this is a performance recording of one popular booking site, reservation site. And here, for example, is one bundle that was, of course, I applied some throttling because CPU and network throttling to better match real world conditions. And for example, this bundle takes 240 milliseconds to load. 240 seconds, OK. But as soon as it's loaded, it takes another hopping 150 milliseconds to execute. So more than half of the time it took to load. And that's really a lot. And in fact, this thing largely depends on the kinds of the script you use and the kinds of the script you serve. But still, this is a typical picture. For every JavaScript bundle that takes a lot of time to load, it takes also almost as much time to execute, especially on lower-end devices like lower-end laptops and lower-end mobile phones. Cool. So the solution for improving time to interactive, serverless JavaScript. And how to serverless JavaScript? You use code splitting, and you optimize your dependencies. And let's talk about code splitting. When you have a single, simple, plain, single-page app, the simplest approach is to build it into a single bundle and serve that bundle to the client. And, well, it works. That obviously works. But the problem with this is that this bundle has a lot of code that's not related to the current page. Like, if you have, for example, 10 pages, and the user visits to see just a single page, they would still have to download the whole app, the whole 10 pages code. And even though they, after seeing this one page, they might just close the tab. And this really affects your time to interactive, this really affects your product matrix. So the solution for this is code splitting. And with code splitting, you first, you split your whole huge bundle into smaller files, for example, per route. Then, for each page, for each request, you serve only those files, those smaller files that are needed right now. And then you prefetch the remaining files in the background, and you want to prefetch them to make future navigations faster. This is like also important for your metrics. And again, I wouldn't want to do this manually, but it's 2018. We have tools. And again, Next.js. Next.js does code splitting automatically, as I mentioned, and it does automatic code splitting per routes, and you can prefetch the routes you need with the prefetch attribute. Yeah, I've mentioned this. Then for Webpack, there's this import function. I've mentioned it briefly. I'll now describe it in more details. For example, we have that one large JavaScript model that only gets used like twice a week or twice a month. And this JavaScript model takes half a bundle. And if you serve everything in one bundle, the user would have to load this model every time they visit the app, unless it's cached, of course, every time they visit the app, but still they won't use the model at all. So what you do in this case, you stop serving your model with your main bundle, and instead you move your model to a different bundle, to a different file. And to do this, you remove your static import, like import model from rarely used model. You wrap your import with an import function, and Webpack will fetch that bundle. Webpack will move that model into a separate file and will fetch that file only when you execute that import function. And you can also prefetch that bundle earlier, actually, with the Webpack prefetch tree. Plus, as I mentioned, there's Webpack Workbox Webpack plugin, and it prefetches files with the service worker, and it works great because it prefetches all files, not just JavaScript bundles from neighbor routes. The only problem with it is that it might conflict with the previous methods, but still it works nice. Okay, so, and yeah. The second thing, the second approach to improve time to interactive is optimize your dependencies. And what this means. Moment.js, by default, includes 105 minified kilobytes of localization files, which aren't necessary at all unless your app uses all these localizations. React. With React, you still serve all your prop types in the production bundle, despite prop types aren't used with production Webpack, with production React, sorry. React just doesn't do prop type check in production. With Lodash, it's too easy to include the whole library into the bundle, even though you still use, you only use like a couple of methods from that bundle. And there are lots of such libraries and lots of such pitfalls. And as a solution for this, we, with Google, made a repository with tricks for a number of popular JavaScript libraries and tips for optimizing them. So if you have Lodash, if you use Lodash, if you use Web, if you use React, if you use Babel Polyfill, you could go to this repository, find your libraries there, see what plugin you should add to optimize your library, and make your bundle less, less kilobytes smaller. And cool, that's it about time to interactive. To improve time to interactive, you do code splitting, and to improve time to interactive, you do you optimize your dependencies with the trap I just mentioned. And the final thing I want to talk today is how to keep the app fast, because you know it's one thing to make your app fast, and it's called it's a fairly different thing to keep your app fast like always after you made it fast. And the best solution for keeping your app fast, the best solution I found, is to just make yourself constantly aware of your app performance. Like, constantly track your app metrics. Make shoot those digits into your face. Make yourself constantly aware of them. And for this, we also have tools. One of such tools is Webpack Dashboard. Webpack Dashboard is an alternative output for Webpack, which prints a lot of information Webpack doesn't print. And how it works, you launch your Webpack dev server, you launch your Webpack dashboard alongside, and Webpack dashboard shows you your file, your library, your dependency sizes, Webpack dashboard shows you your asset sizes, and Webpack dashboard shows you the problems you have in your bundle. And what's cool, you might actually, what's cool is that by constantly looking there, you might actually start wondering why is this library so large and how can I optimize it? So this is Webpack dashboard. You can install it from NPM. Then there's a Lighthouse CI tool. This tool allows you to run your Lighthouse on your CI, obviously. So if you are able to build your app for each new pull request, you can actually build your app for each new pull request and run Lighthouse audits through for your app on each pull request. And each time you do a pull request, you can see how has your metric changed and stuff like that. It can be installed from its repo. And finally, there's also the bundle size tool, which is an NPM tool and an CI tool. And it tracks your bundle size. And it can even fail your pull request checks if your bundle gets large. So it's also cool. Use it. And yeah, it could be installed. It could also be installed from its repository. And that's it for the talk today. It was Ivan Akulov, founder of 3prev.com. We help companies makes up faster by makes up faster and there are more, and we work with Google and several other companies. And build faster apps because it's fucking important for your product. Thanks.
Thank you, and you are welcome for our short interview.
Mm-hmm. And we will remove Coco because I envy her popularity.
Can I touch it? Yeah, cool.
You can take it.
No. Okay. So the first question is: with all those awesome tools, there is two big problems that I have. Like the first one is the build time. So mm-hmm. for example, if we apply all of those optimization, mm-hmm. like we do the best job possible. Mm-hmm. The build time can skyrocket like to mm-hmm. infinity, like mm-hmm. 20, 30 minutes. And developer experience actually can go down because mm-hmm. it's like a small change of one mm-hmm. character can lead to
makes sense.
20, 30 minutes of yeah. development. So do you think it's a problem? Do you think there's anything possible to do yeah. with that?
So I think actually... I think developer, increasing the build time is actually a reasonable trade-off. Like, you make your builds longer, but you make your users happier, and you actually improve your product metrics and earn more in the end. The thing I would do in this case, but yeah, that's actually the problem. And the thing I would do in this case, I would probably move all the optimizations as far into the as far into the end of the pipeline as possible. Like, obviously, don't apply them on every development or build. Don't apply them. Probably don't apply them for your staging. Apply them only for your production builds, where it's probably okay to wait 20, 30 minutes to apply for all optimizations. But it like improves your business.
And I think performance is now is feature is not feature. It's a requirement. What do you think about it?
Well, on one hand, yes, it's probably a requirement because it affects your product metrics and stuff like that. On the other hand, the problem with that, lots of businesses don't care about performance because A, they have features to build, and B, they don't know how performance affects their product. So one of my missions, as I see it, is to tell everyone how performance actually affects their products so they become more aware of this. And as a requirement, the major problem, I think, this won't actually become as important until we probably have allowed to make all sites render in 2-3 seconds. Like, we have some laws for accessibility. Probably, yeah. Okay, I was trying to make a joke, but I went the wrong way, so it's not a joke now. But okay.
It's okay. Uh-huh. And I have a tiny question, not related to the topic of your talk, mm-hmm. but your company is called 3perf.com.
Perf, actually.
Perf. Yeah. If I'm not mistaken in pronunciation.
Uh-huh.
I think perf standing for performance. Mm-hmm. What does it mean, 3perf?
Like, okay. Actually, the full name of the company is perf. If you go to the site. They're actually they've hidden. There was a link to slides, like 3perf.com/subscribe. Go and leave your email, and I will send you slides today, especially you. Not especially you. Okay, especially for you. Yes, but that word. Anyway, it's perf, and 3perf is like three times perf. So that's it.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.